All right, last time we were looking at the temperature. Did somebody solve for the temperature on number 83? What was that? Was it number 83? And then
How many sig figs were you allowed?
Five
sig figs, yeah. You're allowed?
Okay,
so 6.4321.
Yes.
What was the sixth digit then? This one, you know, this one is a pretty tricky one as far as sig figs go. How did you come up with 5 sig figs? Okay. Because when I look at the equation, some of the values have 4 sig figs.
I got 8.8.
You got 8.8?
With 2 sig figs.
With 2 sig figs? Yeah, this one is very complicated because whenever you have like addition, subtraction, and then not only that, you have a quadratic here, it makes it tough. And so, you know, if you look at that, and how did you get 2 sig figs? Did you go through all the steps? And
right.
So did you solve it using the quadratic formula?
At the end.
Okay, then yeah, then you're probably right. It'd be just 2 sig figs. If it were 2 sig figs, it would be 6.4, we'd subscript the 3, and what are the units here?
Kelvin.
Can't be Kelvin. This is for water.
Okay.
Yeah, water would be pretty frozen at this time. It has to be degrees Celsius. In fact, this equation is only valid between, what was it, 0 and 40 degrees, or 0 and 20 degrees Celsius. You know, and the thing is, you know, we have an empirical equation like this, and it's like an average, you know? If you're given an average, how much should you trust the average, right? So, for example, somebody might say, well, you know, I did this problem, I got an average. The average was 2.4 grams per milliliter. They're trying to figure out the density of something, some metal, right? And so this is the average density. But, you know, how much certainty do you have in this particular average? And you might go, wow, that, you know, this is fairly precise. You know, plus or minus what? Plus or minus, you know, 0.05. That's what we say as far as the sig figs go, right? As far as the sig figs go, you'd say something like this. However, we don't know what the original data was that they averaged. And so let me talk about that in just a sec. We have the MESA facilitator visiting us.
Hi,
guys. And he's going to introduce the MESA program this semester. So
yeah.
Anytime's fine, so yeah. Go ahead.
So good morning, guys. My name is Juan, and I'm the MESA facilitator for Chemistry 1A for MESA. And MESA's going to be holding a workshop for Chemistry 1A. And this workshop is going to be all Tuesday and Thursday from 12 to 12:30 in Physics 113. And you don't have to be a MESA. You don't have to be a MESA in order to go to the workshops. It's free for all the students that are enrolled in the Chem 1A class. So, you know, we'll have worksheets and we'll practice about chemistry and all that stuff. So I really hope to see you there, guys. All right, so we have this little flyer. Can you pass it around, please? So you can have the information and then hope to see you guys. All right? Yeah, so we're going to start, next week. All right, so don't shut tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's a free program that's worth taking advantage of if you don't know much about it. And there's no I guess no, well, they expect some commitment, but you don't have to be locked into the commitment. So, normally when we show something like this, but in science, in science we show uncertainty in a different way. We show uncertainty to give us an idea of how good this average is. And let's say this average came about, from something like this. Let's say one value was 3.4, another value was 1.4, and then a third value was 2.4. And they average these three numbers to get 2.4. How much confidence do you have in that 2.4? Would you say that, oh, that's 2.4 plus or minus 0.05? No way. I mean, normally when we think about this precision, no, this is just all over the place, Who knows, if they took a fourth measurement, what would happen? Let's say the fourth measurement they took, they got 6.3. Wow. Now average four of those measurements. Do you see how bad that average is? That average you can't have much confidence in. And so in science, what we do is we do a plus or minus, but the plus or minus I've been talking about is the plus or minus for the precision of the instrument itself, whatever instrument you're using to take that measurement. But in science, the way we report this kind of uncertainty is via a plus or minus, what we call a lambda 95%. And this is what we call a 95% confidence interval. And the 95% confidence interval, we do statistical analysis of the spread of this. And so in this 95%, if the original data is spread all over the place, the 95% is going to be quite wide, the interval. If the data was very tight, let's say in the first measurement they got to 2.3, in the second measurement 2.4, in the third measurement they got 2.5. You often see three measurements in science. Do you know why? Why not an infinite number? Well, of course, an infinite number would be way too what? Well, impossible, obviously. This is way too time-consuming. But, the more measurements you have, the more you're going to average out that what? The more you're going to average out the
random error.
Random error, right? And so, obviously, we want to take a lot of measurements. But the more measurements you take, the more time, right? And so as far as uncertainty goes, as far as 95%, it's not linear. If you take one measurement, then the uncertainty is very high, right? You don't know. But if you take two measurements, uncertainty is much smaller. Three measurements, it becomes smaller. It's not linear like this. And so the biggest cost versus benefit comes with three measurements. Three measurements has way less uncertainty than two measurements does. Four measurements is better, but not hugely better. And so most people say, well, four measurements is going to take a lot of time to do a fourth experiment. Is it really worth the reduction in my 95% confidence interval to make it worth it? Yeah, sometimes it is. You gotta see, if it's a quick experiment, then no problem, take 1,000, But if it's a time-consuming experiment, then you'll see. Most people will do three because that's the statistical best compromise as far as time versus minimizing random error, right? And so this is the things that we think about in science and measurement. Measurement, the thing about science that makes it difficult is how to interpret the numbers, right? If you get an average, you don't treat all averages the same. You can't, because the averages are based on different raw data. And so, as a scientist, we have to be able to interpret the numbers and place some kind of, value judgment on that. And so here you can see the spread is wide, here the spread is much tighter. We say this is poor precision, this is much higher precision. The much higher precision is going to give us Well, it doesn't always give us more sig figs. In this case, you know, we'd be allowed the, well, actually, if we do the addition of the division, the sig figs come out tricky. Here, the sig fig rules have to be violated because we're only going to have a tenth. You know, the sig fig rules would be violated here. Do you know why? The sig fig rules would be violated here because they don't work in this case. You know, because this is a strange case where it wouldn't work. It wouldn't work, the sig fig rules wouldn't work here because we get 3.4 plus 1.4 plus 2.4 plus 6.3. So we do the addition first and then divide it by 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And so go ahead and do that addition. We do the addition and is it going to be? 4, 8, 12, 15. So, and then 4, 5, 7, 13.5. So I do the addition, I'm allowed one decimal place, correct?
Yes.
And then I do the division, and this is division, so this is 3 sig figs. 4 is how many sig figs?
Mm-hmm.
Infinite sig figs, right? Because it's just 4 measurements. And so 13.5 divided by 4 is equal to what?
3.375.
Okay, 3.375. Now, this is 3 sig figs, right? This is 3 sig figs. And so now all of a sudden, my uncertainty is in the, not the tenth, but my uncertainty is in the hundredth place. But look at all my raw data. The uncertainty is in the tenth, 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 tenth. How can all of a sudden I become more certain? I can't. So here, sig figs has failed because really the uncertainty is here in the tenth. This should be 3.4, right? But unfortunately, the sig fig rules didn't work. But you know, we know that the sig fig rules aren't perfect. They're going to suit us, but sometimes they don't work. And in cases where they don't work, we should use what? We should use propagation. See, the thing is, if it didn't register yesterday, then it's not going to register before the test. If somebody asked you that question before on the test, you wouldn't get it, basically, you know. And so all that, you know, little bits of information here, little bits of information here, means by the time the exam comes along, you only know about 20% of the information that was presented in class, you know. 30, 40, some people say 40% of the information people remember for the test. Sometimes less, you know. I know people who don't take any notes, and they know about, you know, less than 5% of the information that was presented in class when they go in to take the exam. And, my roommate. But anyway, former roommate. So, you know, when we do measurements, we think about these things. We think about the uncertainties and this kind of stuff. And the easiest way to start to get familiar with them is just to talk about them, you know, as we go along. And so we're not going to leave this topic because in lab we're going to be taking a measurement. In lab we're going to calculate the 95% confidence intervals. Even though the lab manual doesn't, I want to do that. And so when we get an average, then you can see, you know. And the thing is, how good is this? Oops. Well, scientists spend a lot of time thinking about uncertainty, you know, and numbers, and how much confidence you can have in particular numbers, you know.
Not only that, they think about equations like this. Equation number 83 here. One question I have is how many people completed the calculation? You know, 1, 2, 3.
I tried, but I had trouble.
Tried, but you had trouble. Well, how many people didn't try at all? Well, most people don't try at all. But you know what you'll find? That, you know, you go to UCLA, everybody does the problems. Well, you would think everybody does the problems. But there's an interesting story I had from, not my roommate, but this is from UCSB. When I was at UCSB, one of the professors there was talking to me about his class, you know. His class was full of chemistry graduate students. And so he's a theoretical chemist. And so he went through and did this, you know, 2-day derivation of some theoretical concept. The class is very small. There's only like 6 students in the class. So he asked the class, you know, do you guys get it? Does it make sense? Everybody said it made sense, you know, and they got it. So he gave them a pop quiz, you know, and that was, I guess, the next day, and only one person got it. Only one person got it, and so we were talking about this, and the situation is like this, you know, people, it does, I'm sure it does make sense when somebody is, somebody's guiding you. It's like, you know, have you ever been to an unfamiliar place? Let's say you go to a jungle, and there are a whole bunch of paths through the jungle, but none of them are marked, you know? But you go with somebody who's been there for 30 years, living there, you know, walking these paths every day, and you follow that person, you go, oh, that was easy. I know how to get from point A to point B because I just followed this person, right? And then the next day you're there, and the next day you have to go by yourself. And all of a sudden, when you go by yourself, there are a whole bunch of alternate paths that you didn't notice before because you're just focused on following this person. And all these alternate paths all of a sudden start to get you mixed up and confused as to how to get from point A to point B, right? And so this is a similar situation because when you go with somebody who's done it, I mean, or when you watch somebody who's done it for 30 years, you know, it's pretty easy because they know all the things to avoid. And they know how to just get there without making any mistakes, right? And it seems easy, but when you start it, then you go down all these wrong paths and you make a lot of mistakes, right? And so, you know, that's one analogy. You know, just because it seems easy, it could be because they know exactly, you know, what direction they're going and what they need to do. The other thing is, learn by watching. A lot of people like to learn by watching, but, you know, chemistry, you can't really do that because it's like it would be like the piano, you know. Can you learn by watching somebody play the piano? You know, if you watch them enough, it'll just sink in, or some, you know, instrument. Not that I can't even play the piano, but, you know, if I watch somebody play, there's no way I'd be able to do what they did, right? And so the same thing goes here. You know, you have to test yourself, and this is something I did on my notes. Every problem that was presented in class, I redid myself from scratch, from the beginning, to make sure I understood it inside and out, right? And I don't understand, you know, this is something that you'll see a lot of, but you'll see a lot of students not do it, and a lot of students that don't do it aren't as successful as the students that do it. And so, you know, just because I wrote a problem, I didn't finish it, you should try to finish it, because then you can, you know, okay, you get stuck on something, you can get it cleared up before the test. A lot of people, they get stuck on something the night before the test. Oh, how do I do that? You know, and then the stress level builds. Well, we're talking about uncertainty. There's uncertainty in measurements. There's also uncertainty in equations. Like for this equation, is this a perfect fit for the density? This is the density of water. Liquid water, the density of liquid water from 0 to 20 degrees C looks something like this. If I look at the density, you know, the density peaks. Do you know where the density peaks around? What temperature?
4 degrees Celsius.
Around 4 degrees Celsius, we have a little peak here, but it's going to be this kind of polynomial, you know, like a quadratic type curve, right? Squared. So between 0 and 20 degrees, well, one question obviously comes up. What happens after 20 degrees C?
If they're limiting it between 0 and 20 degrees C, you know what that means? This equation is probably only valid from 0 to 20 degrees C. Beyond 20 degrees C, we need another equation. Because this is just an empirical equation. An empirical equation is what? This should be automatic by now. This should be like the third day or something, or second day. Huh?
You read it in chapter one, but it's...
The thing is, you know, the amount of information obviously is going to grow. And so the best time is not to let the information pile up and pile up and pile up and say, I'm gonna learn that right before the test, right? The best time is this to do it now, especially when it comes to the final. You know, I have students that are totally stressed out and extremely worried about final exams every single semester. And they complain, there's too much stuff. You're throwing too much stuff at us. You're throwing too much stuff at me. You know, I get a lot of complaints, actually, near the end of the semester. So be prepared for that. And the way you prepare for that is to, you know, learn it as we go along. And so, you know, make sure you're able to do this. But since we're talking about uncertainty, I want to talk about this. And since we're going to be doing this also in the semester, and that is, you know, an empirical equation, somebody's got to know. What is an empirical equation? You know what an empirical formula is, right? But this is different than an empirical formula. This is an empirical equation. Let's take a look at this here for a moment. A lot of ads in this. This is an engineer's toolbox. I should have found something without a lot of ads. Can you guys read that? You guys see that? And so they're just based on the experimental data. If they're based on the experimental data, then we run into a situation like this. How good is this equation? How much confidence can I have in this equation? Is this equation an exact fit, a perfect fit of the experimental data, or is it a close fit? And so, have you guys done this in math? Let me ask you: have you done a linear least squares fit in math? Linear least squares fit? No? All right. Well, we can figure out how good this is by looking at the actual data point. And so, you know, because of random error, what we often see is the data points don't actually match. Unless, you know, sometimes the data is above, sometimes it's below. What you try to do in a linear least squares fit is you try to have as many dots above the line as kind of below the line and try to go through as many dots as possible in graphing. Have you done that?
But sometimes there's data way off the line.
Right.
If there's data way off the line, then what do we say? If all the data is right on the line, then it's a perfect fit, right? If the data is right on the line, let's say, oh, this is a perfect fit here, right on the line. If all the data is right on the line, then, you know, that's a perfect fit. If there's some data off the line, you know, sometimes there's data out here. You know? Have you done any correlations in, like in humanities, they do correlations. And they say if there's a 60% correlation, it's okay, I think, you know? But in science, we want a little bit better correlation. And so what we do is we use statistics again. We use statistics and we come up with a value. There's a correlation factor, R squared value. And so that's what's missing here. Normally in science, we have an R squared telling us how good this fits. And so when we have averages presented in the book, you always got to think, hey, we have an average there. What's the 95% confidence interval? Well, normally it's not given in this book, right? But normally we think about that so we have some idea of how much uncertainty we have in that. When we're given an empirical equation like this, we often think, okay, what's the R squared value for that equation? You know, that'll tell me how good this equation fits the actual data, the actual observations. All right, so those are some additional topics in uncertainty that are very important. Around. And so this book just focuses on some precision and accuracy. This is not enough. You know, we need more than that. And so we might as well start learning it now rather than later. So I don't know. But anyway, we need to go ahead and make sure we could do calculations of this sort. All right. For about 90% of the problems in Chem 1A, you could use dimensional analysis. But there are problems where we have to use more than dimensional analysis, like the quadratic formula in the last problem, a system of equations. You know, if we wanted to solve the problem with the chlorinating solution correctly, you know, there were two unknowns here. One unknown was the volume of the swimming pool. We don't know what the total volume of the swimming pool is going to be because we're going to add some chlorinating solution to it, which is going to change the volume. And we don't know how much chlorinating solution we're going to add to it, right? And so we had to solve that system of equations, although I put it into one equation. Normally you do, you know, two equations, two unknowns. I just thought I just put it into one. Well, let's take a look at this. Tell me how you're going to solve this. Can we solve this using dimensional analysis or not? Let's go to number 76. Okay. A Fahrenheit and a Celsius thermometer are immersed in the same medium. What Celsius temperature will the numerical reading on the Fahrenheit thermometer be? Okay, A, 49 degrees less than that on the Celsius thermometer. And so I have this is 76. It's hard to read there. Is that okay? So we have two thermometers in here. We have a Fahrenheit and we have a Celsius. And so we want the 49 degrees less than the Celsius. So we want the Fahrenheit temperature to be 49. So this is going to be X degrees Celsius. We don't know what that is, right? But we know that the Fahrenheit temperature should be 49 degrees less than that, right?
Yeah.
And so how should I write that? Maybe I'll write the temperature of degrees Fahrenheit is X minus 49. Well, I have a problem here. I have two unknowns, right?
I have two unknowns. One unknown is the temperature in Fahrenheit, and the other unknown is X, the temperature in Celsius. I don't know what the Celsius temperature is. I don't know what the Fahrenheit temperature is. So if I have two unknowns, how am I going to solve this?
Two equations.
Right, system of equations. So we need two equations. Can you come up with two equations to solve this?
So why don't you take a minute and see if you can come up with two equations to solve this problem. You could do guess and check, but that's going to take you a long time. Do you know what guess and check is?
Yeah.
Guess and check is also given a fancy name. It's called the method of successive approximations. And so we'll just guess the Celsius temperature. I'm going to guess the Celsius temperature of, or guess a Fahrenheit temperature. The Celsius would be 39. And then calculate the other temperature and see, is it 49 degrees? Less, but that would be not the best way to solve this, because especially on an exam, you need to solve things quickly. All right, when somebody has it, let me know. The equation, I mean. Does somebody have it? Well, you know, so this is kind of like building up the knowledge, you know, in your brain. You want to expose yourself to a lot of different problems. Mm-hmm. And one way to expose yourself to a lot of different problems is to look at a lot of different problems. This is, you think about this. If you were hit with this cold, you know, on a test, versus if you at least saw something similar to this on a test, right? It makes a big difference. Not only that, when you have to do a lot of different variations of the same kind of problem solving, then you're much more, let's say, much more capable of solving higher, harder, much more challenging problems. You know? And so you just kind of build, and you know, what I do, if I had a problem like this on the homework, or if I was just looking through the problems, and I did try to, after, you know, talking, I did try to do all the problems in the book, at least read them, you know. I'd spend a few minutes, you know, if it wasn't clicking, then I have two choices, you know, set it aside, let my subconscious work, or just look at the solutions manual. Right. In a beginning class like this, I would look at the solutions manual. You know, for more advanced classes, I'd try to let it sit. You know, but if you're just learning this stuff, you know, at the beginner level, well, you know, general chems, you know, it's not a total beginner, but it's somewhat, then you want to see a lot of examples, right? Not just look at one problem, dimensional analysis. You're an expert at dimensional analysis, right? But you missed other ones like system of equations, like quadratic. You know, can you solve that quadratic? You know, math is, you know, math, you think, oh, this is not a math class, but unfortunately, you know, if you don't get the right answer, and the math is what held you back, you're still going to get a deduction. Well, you know, this, the thing is, you make connections, right? And how do you make connections? You make connections because you've seen it before, or you've seen something similar. In fact, you've seen something very similar. I did it in number 69, but I skipped some steps. But these are things you notice if you have the luxury of time. You would never notice these types of things if you're doing this the night before, right? And so let me tell you in number 69, did we know the volume of the pool, the final volume of the pool? Because it doesn't matter what the initial volume of the pool was, 18,000 gallons, and getting 18,000 gallons to 1 ppm, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to dump some chlorinating solution, and then I get solution dilution. It's going to be less than 1 ppm. I don't want it less than 1 ppm. I want to do it right. Right? Okay, but you know, doing it right versus there's a trade-off here. You know, how much error do you think we introduce by assuming, you know, that the volume of chlorinating solution didn't really change the volume of the swimming pool much? How much error do you think? We introduce barely any error. And so in that case, you know, with so little error introduced, you know, doing it right could have been just ignoring that, this volume. But we never know because it depends. You know, sometimes you have to add a lot. And so this is an unknown. Do we know the volume of the pool? No, but whatever that volume is, you know, in gallons, we have to convert it. Remember, what do we do? We converted it to liters. We converted that to milliliters. We converted that to grams. We converted that to grams of chlorine. We converted that to milliliters of chlorinating solution, etc. Right? And then at the end of this, we got liters, you know, x liters of chlorinating solution. And so we have two unknowns. We have x, and we have the volume of the pool. Right? But here I'm going to use a simple equation that I know. I know that the volume of pool is given by another equation. The volume of the pool is going to be 18,000 gallons plus x. Well, x is in liters, so I have to convert it to gallons, right? Convert to gallons. So the gallons can add to gallons. I can't add liters to gallons, right? The units don't work. But whatever it is, x, right? Now, okay, this is a conversion factor, this is a conversion, all these are known conversion factors. And so the only other unknown is x. And in this case, it'd be gallons. We'll just change it to gallons for right now. And then later on, we'll change it to liters. Now I only have one equation and
one unknown.
Well, you know what? This is the same thing. Okay, the temperature in degrees Fahrenheit is equal to x degrees Celsius, right, minus 49 degrees. Well, the temperature in degrees Fahrenheit is equal to 9/5
x degrees, that's the Celsius, plus 32 degrees. So now I just have one equation and one unknown.
So that's my system of equations, exact same kind of problem. You know, and same type of situation. You see that? And so you start to notice the connections once you've done these and you've let your subconscious work, then you'll say, oh, that's the same as that earlier problem. You know? The book, if you look at the solutions manual, the book ignores the additional x here. And we do that a lot in chemistry. Because if we factor in the x, it makes the calculation a little bit more difficult, a little bit more time-consuming, and did it make much difference? You know, adding 0.8 liters, less than 1 liter to 18,000 gallons, isn't going to change the volume much. Let's say, oh, you know what? If I have a swimming pool and I add a drop of water to it, should I recalculate the volume of the swimming pool? No, the drop of water is no big deal. You wouldn't care one way or the other, right? But mathematically, the volume has just increased. So a lot of mathematicians will say that's wrong. You know, you can't add a drop of water. The volume's not the same. It can't be the same, right? We have to recalculate the volume. But to a chemist, they look, okay, what's the end result? It's not going to make any difference. And so this is why we have to know numbers, and we have to know what numbers mean, because that dictates how we do calculations. Because in chemistry, in science, what happens is mathematics gets very complicated. As mathematics gets very complicated, you know, it becomes very difficult to do, and therefore we like to make assumptions. We like to make, okay, we're going to assume this, we're going to assume that, to make the calculations much easier to do. And so this is why we spend time thinking about uncertainty, thinking about error, thinking about these, because these types of things will help us in our calculations. You know, especially, you know, if you go on, I know you guys are just starting in science, but if you go on in science, you go to the presentation or give a presentation to a group of scientists, the group of scientists are going to start asking you, you know, is that valid? Why did you do that? What are you doing here? Now, normally, oh, I did the calculation, I punched the numbers in, I got this answer. So for example, in Chem 4, this is the Chem 4 level. In Chem 4 level, we might have something like this. We might have, let's calculate the volume of hydrogen gas versus the volume of CO2 gas. Under the same conditions, you know, N, P, and T are the same. Do you know the volume of the ideal gas at any temperature? Did you memorize STP?
No.
No? Yes? What's the volume? STP is 1 ATM, and what's the volume of the gas at STP?
No. 22.4 liters.
You know,
when I was in intro chem, actually starting in high school, I took chemistry in high school too. Starting in high school, I memorized STP. I had it memorized in high school, 22.4 liters per mole of gas, right? And I had it memorized throughout, but you know what? It turned out I never used it for anything, basically. A few calculations here or there, but STP wasn't that useful.
But anyway, let's say it's 22.4 liters, and this will be 22.4 liters. Are these two numbers the same? To a Chem 4 student, they're the same, right? But to a Chem 1A student, they aren't the same. They aren't the same because, and we'll talk about this in Chapter 6, because one of these gases is more ideal than the other gas. Do you know which one's more ideal? Hydrogen's more ideal than CO2. Therefore, this number is more accurate for hydrogen, less accurate for CO2. So do you see what I mean by numbers? When you continue on science, people are going to ask you about numbers. And you have to think about numbers. And we think about numbers all the time. You know, people are going to ask you, you know, how much confidence can I have in your numbers? They might not have any confidence in your numbers. So you have to defend, you know, your numbers.
As scientists are generally skeptical, you know, of stuff. They just want to make sure things were done right. That's all.
All right, so we have this equation. Now we just solve this for x. And you watch somebody do that, and you go, oh, that's simple. I could do that. But then the time comes for the exam, and you go, do this, do that, you know? And so you got to make sure to do that.
And therefore, these other questions should be pretty easy, I think. 76b, let's look at that.
The Fahrenheit temperature will be twice that on the Celsius. And so at what temperature is the Fahrenheit double the Celsius? You know, this is the same medium. And so, well, that's not bad. If we call the Celsius X, then the Fahrenheit will be 2x degrees C, let's say. And then plug it in there. Right? I'm sorry?
Just put parentheses on that area.
Yeah, you can put parentheses on that or whatever. I mean, we just have 2x solve for x. At what temperature will the Fahrenheit be 1/8 that on the Celsius thermometer? You know, maybe it's no temperature, you know? Why don't I come up with something like this? This might be a trick question here. Actually, I think all these work. I think all these are valid. So for example here, 1/8, and then D, 300 degrees more than that on the Celsius thermometer. And the thing is this. You have to realize also that in Chem 4 and Intro Chem, you know, they want to make sure the problems work nicely. And so they're very selective. Oh, you know, we better not do this problem because that problem is going to screw people up, right? And so we're going to just kind of ignore it. And so in Intro Chem, even in Chem 1A, you know, sometimes we'll ignore certain problems because they pose, you know, they're much more challenging and they pose difficulty in interpreting. But in Chem 1A, we're going to try to avoid that more and more. You know, we want to tackle things that aren't so clean. Because we'll talk more about it as we go along. But sometimes you get thrown this problem. Let's try this. I'm going to call this E. Okay, I want to go at, I want a Fahrenheit temperature that's going to be 900 degrees bigger than the Celsius. And so the thermometer is measuring both. You know, 900, this has got to be hot. Whatever it is very hot. And so we have the Celsius temperature, it's going to be X degrees. We want the Fahrenheit temperature to be X plus 900. And so let's figure this one out. Okay. And so the other equation I can come up with is just the equation we derived the other day. Temperature in degrees Fahrenheit is equal to X degrees plus 900 degrees, which is going to equal 9/5 X degrees plus 32 degrees. And so, okay, I'm going to go ahead and calculate this now. Here.
I think it's 300.
Which one?
300.
Oh, 300? Oh, 300 is going to work. 300, you'll have a. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to throw one more. The reason why is all these work, but in life,
not everything works. You know, in life, somebody might ask you this question, you know, and so what do you say? You know, where things, well, let's see if this works. Okay, let's see if this works.
Maybe it works. Maybe I have to find something else, you know, that doesn't work. Let me show you. Because, you know, we have to know what numbers mean. And so if this one works, then I'm going to show you one other one that's not as clean. How about that?
let's subtract 32 from both sides.
868.
And then let's add x to both sides. So I'll add 5 fifths x, so this is going to give me 14 fifths.
It's 868.
Oh. It's 868?
Correct.
Degrees Fahrenheit?
No, 886 is supposed to be 868.
Oh, 868 times 5 divided by 14.
Wouldn't you
subtract
the x?
Oh, you're right. You're right. I made a mistake. We need to subtract the x. So this is not going to be 14 fifths. This is going to be 4 fifths. Thanks. What does it come out to? 1,085. Oh, okay. So if we had, you know, if we had a temperature of 1,085 degrees Celsius, then the Fahrenheit temperature should be 900 degrees higher than that. What we want to do is we would like to double check the answer. Is there a way we could double check this answer? Yeah, we'll just plug it back in and see what the Fahrenheit comes out to. And so if I plug it back in, it's kind of circular, but this also checks if you made any calculation errors. And it also just gives you confidence in it if we get the same answer. So let's go ahead and plug this in. 9 fifths, 1085 degrees plus 32 degrees. So what does that come out to?
$19.85
at work. 19, so it's 900 degrees bigger than the Celsius, right? That worked. So, well, that worked. Let's try this. The next problem I'm going to try is, this was 49 degrees less than the Celsius temperature. Let's try something else. I'm going to go with this. I want a temperature that's going to be 500 degrees less than the Celsius temperature. So that was E, this is going to be F. And so I want my temperature in degrees Fahrenheit to be equal to my Celsius minus 500 degrees. Go for that. Well, mathematically no problem, right? This is going to be 9 fifths x degrees plus 32 degrees. Let's solve for x. So what I'll do is I'll subtract 32 from both sides. So I'm going to get minus 532 degrees, and then subtract 5 fifths. So I'll get 4 fifths x degrees, and then x, the Celsius temp, will be what?
Six six five.
Okay. Negative 665 degrees Celsius.
Is there any problem with the map? Did everybody get it? So we're right. We have the right answer, correct? But no, this is not the right answer. This is a serious problem.
We can't go lower then. Huh? This temperature is impossible. We can't go lower than what?
not 373. We can't go lower than minus 273. Minus 273 is the absolute zero temperature. So this is an impossible temperature. And so what we have to say is that there's no temperature that satisfies this. Even though the math worked out fine, you know, a lot of people said, what did I do wrong? The math is all right. Well, it's not the math. It's your understanding of what numbers mean. You don't understand what the numbers mean. That's a problem. And so imagine you're at a conference and you're telling, you know, everybody, we just need to drop the temperature to minus 670, 665 degrees Celsius. What are people going to think? Well, they're going to think you need to go back to Chem 4, basically. And so we got to be aware of that too. I mean, we don't always catch it, you know. Everybody makes mistakes, I guess. But we just try to catch the mistakes, you know, and minimize the number of mistakes that we do. All right, so, you know, there's a lot that goes into measurement and numbers and calculations that we'll be talking about as we go along. But it's not just numbers, you know. And calculations and measurements, it's also conceptual stuff that we have to think about. And so this is going to take us to chapter 2. You know, there's quite a few practice problems in chapter 1. If we go to chapter 2, let's take a look at the topics we're going to cover here. Atoms and atomic theory. Atoms and atomic theory. Maybe we'll just do a show of hands here because normally I'll take a little mini quiz here, but. How many of you believe in atoms? Okay. Not everybody? Okay, prove it to me. Why do you believe in atoms? Give me some proof. Things might repel, but other things might repel too, not necessarily atoms. Prove it to me.
Atoms make up everything.
Although, what's that?
Images
of atoms? Okay, that's good. There is an overwhelming amount of proof that atoms exist, right? Overwhelming. Although Rutherford was about atomic structure, you know, the inside of the atoms, not the atoms themselves. But, you know, you have to be careful. You have to be careful because, you know, some people will say, you know, my seventh grade science teacher told me about atoms, and I trust my seventh grade science teacher to be telling me the truth about that. And therefore, do you think that argument's going to hold up? And this is it. It might not be atoms, but it could be something else. And like I said, in science, somebody's going to ask for proof. You know, somebody's going to want to see some experimental evidence or some theoretical evidence of that. Now, if you think back to Dalton's time, did Dalton have a scanning tunneling microscope? No. Did Dalton have an X-ray diffractometer? No. And so when somebody asked Dalton to prove that atoms exist, what type of proof did Dalton have that atoms exist?
Mathematical.
No, he didn't use mathematical proof either. Well, a little bit mathematical, but it was more of what? Theoretical? Did Dalton come up with the theory? He did come up with the theory of atoms, atomic theory, but what proof is there for atomic theory? You know, atoms and atomic theory.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
okay, let's go back to the scientific method. Actually, Dalton used the scientific method. What are the steps of the scientific method?
Observation.
So the observation, that led to atomic theory, I told you before, I think. What, do you recall what it was? I mentioned it. I didn't write it down. I just mentioned it. The observation that led to this is that what was observed in chemical reactions was that the mass of the reactants, the total mass of the reactants, is equal to the total mass of product.
Conservation of mass.
Right. Right. And so this was a pattern that was reproduced. Pattern seen over and over again. In fact, they didn't find any violations.
You know, no violation. If they find a lot of violations, then you don't continue with this. But there were no violations. This, at least with the instruments that they had, they couldn't see. And so if you burn a candle, obviously the candle mass goes down, but all the CO2 and the water vapor you generate more than makes up for it, you know? And we end up with that. And so since it's a pattern seen over and over, we call it law. What is the law called? Yeah, this is the law of conservation of mass. And that just means the mass of the initial is equal to the mass of the final. Conservation of mass. There are different ways that people say that. They say that matter is neither created nor destroyed, and just rearranged. And so from this law, you know, came the hypothesis of atoms. And you think, well, sure, you could have conservation of mass, but do you have to believe in atoms? Can't conservation of mass occur without atoms? You know, where's the connection there? And so imagine you're Dalton and you're going in front of a group of skeptical scientists, you know? Are you going to be able to hold up a picture of atoms like this? No. And so how does he convince people? Do you think it was an easy thing to do? No. And so if you think about that time, you know, you have to have a lot of respect for something like that, because, you know, nowadays with modern instrumentation and everything else, that job is a lot easier. But back in Dalton's time, that job wasn't easy. You know, there are competing theories. Do you know what competing theory there was for this? Some kind of ether? Did you hear about that one? Mm-hmm. Yeah. That matter was infinitely divisible. But anyway, continuing on with this, that led to the hypothesis of atoms, you know? And then finally, it led to the theory. What should theories do? Yeah, it should be a fundamental picture. Well, the fundamental picture is matter consists of tiny particles called atoms. And what else should theories do? They should be able to predict, right? And so, you know, Dalton was able to make a prediction. Or, you know, using Dalton's atomic theory, scientists were able to make a prediction. You know what they predicted? The prediction here was the law of multiple proportions. Because if matter did indeed exist as atoms, then, you know, different kinds of matter would combine in simple whole number ratios. Whereas if matter exists, simple whole number ratios in terms of the ratios of masses or the ratios of whatever, if atoms, if matter existed as an ether, then you can have any ratio of hydrogen to oxygen you want, right? Not a fixed ratio of 11% hydrogen by mass and 89% oxygen. Well, you know, the same thing happens because, you know, as you continue in science, it depends on what you do, but, you know, as you continue in science, you don't just repeat what other people have done. You try to find new stuff, right? And the new stuff, you're going to run into the same situation as Dalton. You have to go in front of a group of skeptical scientists and, you know, argue your point, right? And so this, even though you think, wow, that is a tough challenge from Dalton, well, a lot of scientists have to do this. You know, they don't always have clean, perfect data. They have data that has some, you know, they have data that has some things that you know, screw up the interpretation or potentially screw up the interpretation. So what do? You can't ignore it, you know? There's got to be some reason for that. And so it's a challenge. Well, anyway, let's continue with this. This is what we have here. I wonder if they got my account fixed. This is early chemical discoveries in atomic theory, law of conservation of mass. Law of conservation of mass was critical, right? That led to... we have the law of constant composition. Or, a.k.a. the law of definite proportions, a.k.a. the law of multiple proportions. All right, what's Dalton's atomic theory boiled down to? Here, let me... You guys know the theory? Okay. One, you know, each chemical element is composed of minute, indivisible particles. Called atoms. There's Dalton. There. And so Dalton wasn't the first person to propose atoms, but Dalton's atomic theory is the first meaningful theory that was given. And so the first meaningful theory. And so one, you know, matter consists of tiny particles called atoms. Atoms can't be broken down into smaller pieces. And so the smallest piece of matter is an atom. Well, or, you know, a molecule. So something like H2O. This would be like copper. It would be something like H2O. Or what we call a formula unit. Have you ever heard of the word formula unit? A formula unit is, there are some compounds that don't form molecules. Can you name a compound that doesn't form a molecule?
The diatomics.
The diatomics do form molecules. So the smallest piece of, let's say, oxygen that we can have here, you know, the oxygen that we breathe, is O2, an O2 molecule. if we broke it up into single oxygen atoms, it's not going to have the same properties as the oxygen we breathe. We breathe diatomic oxygen. And that diatomic oxygen would be a molecule. We don't want to breathe atomic oxygen. Sometimes we do that. We breathe atomic oxygen when we inhale something like ozone or other things. You know, it's very corrosive. Or a molecule like H2O. Or, you know, what's the smallest piece of salt? You know, I'm on a low-sodium diet. What's the smallest piece of salt I can get? Well, I can try to get the tiniest crystal of salt, right? But that isn't the smallest. What's the smallest? Well, is the smallest piece of salt a sodium chloride molecule? The sodium chloride form molecules? No, sodium chloride does not form molecules. You know, it's an ionic compound. Ionic compounds don't form molecules, molecular compounds. And so the smallest piece of salt I could get would be one sodium ion and one chloride ion. One sodium ion and one chloride ion would be called a formula unit of sodium chloride. If you look at a crystal of salt, and it's not unique, because in a crystal of salt, we have sodiums and chlorides alternating like this. Is this big enough to see? This is called a crystal lattice. And so the bigger the crystal, the more the sodium and chloride ions I have packed together in the crystal lattice, but there aren't, you know, there's not a unique molecule. So for example, I can pick any sodium. In fact, you know, each sodium is not bonded to just one chloride. You know each sodium, how many chlorides it's bonded to? Like this sodium here?
Four.
It's four in the two-dimensional plane. And so this sodium is actually bonded to these four chlorides. This is how the crystal's built up, and you just keep adding more ions. But then there's a chloride on top and a chloride underneath. So altogether, each sodium is bonded to six chlorides. Well, it's just when you look at the ratio, the atom or mole ratio is just one. So all we do is we pick one sodium and pick one of the six chlorides and call that a formula unit, because that would be the smallest chunk. And it doesn't matter which of the six I pick, they're all the same. Does it make sense? So therefore we call it a formula unit. What's the smallest piece of diamond you can have, you know? One atom of carbon, does it have the properties of diamond, or would it have the properties of graphite, or would it have the properties of buckyball, which is another form of carbon, or would it have the properties of atomic carbon? You know, this is the same type of question. When I ask you what is the smallest piece of oxygen, gas that we breathe in, I can have is O2. A single carbon atom isn't going to have the properties of diamond. The smallest chunk of diamond I can have is what we call a unit cell. You know, the diamond behaves the way it is because of how it's bonded structurally. And so we'll talk more about that later when we get into crystals. This is chapter 12, by the way. But we talk about it sooner. And the same thing with diamonds. That would be in chapter 12. And so the smallest, we got atoms. And we can break this apart into atoms of the element by chemical means. The same thing, we can break the ions apart. Actually, those ions can be broken apart by physical means, but they are broken apart into ions, not neutral atoms. And so matter consists of these particles called atoms, or ions in this case. Two, all atoms of the elements are alike in mass and other properties. Well, number two is Dalton didn't know about isotopes. Do you guys know about isotopes? And so number two failed. They found violations of number two, but that's okay, because theories can evolve. Three, in each of their compounds, different elements combine in simple numerical ratios, etc. Read this statement here. Sorry, something happened to my account. Let's
So I thought they were going to fix it. So I know this is hard to read, but like all good theories, Dalton's atomic theory led to a prediction, right? All good theories need to be able to predict new unforeseen results. The law of multiple proportions. This is how you know the theory. If the theory just is a description and you can't predict anything, you know, new, then it's not very useful, right? Well, I guess it still would be useful, but the theories need to be able to predict. One of the theories that came out, and one of the very successful predictions, you know the MRI? The MRI came out as a prediction from theory. And so people predicted that they're going to see this phenomena. It was interesting. It was an interesting story because in the 1950s, the electronics weren't very sophisticated. You know, they had tubes and they didn't have powerful amplifiers. And so in the 1950s, a group of physicists predicted this magnetic resonance phenomena, but the electronics wasn't sophisticated enough to detect. So they tried to detect it. They designed the experiment to detect it and fail. And then later on in the 1960s, electronics were much better. Another group of physicists repeated their experiment and observed the phenomena, you know, the predicted phenomena, and won the Nobel Prize. The original scientists didn't. So that's a big story in a magnetic resonance. Well, anyway, I'll stop here since I'm out of time.